Hi everyone and welcome back to the channel. This is part 2 of chapter 1 of ISCA CA final old syllabus. In this part I'll be dealing with the IT strategy planning and the risk management practices. The first topic is IT strategy planning and we look at all the subtopics under that as well. So the paragraph here, it deals with what are the three levels of the IT structure or structure of the organization. Strategic planning, this occurs at the top of the enterprise. This consists of the members of the board, the IT heads and all the top level functionaries. Management control is the middle level organization, and operational deals with the bottom level managers, that is the operational management level. And classification of strategic planning, this again deals with the same thing in a little more different manner. That is the enterprise strategic plan. Then from the enterprise strategic plan, the information systems strategic plan is derived. And from the information systems strategic plan, the requirements plan and the applications and facilities plan is derived. So we'll look at all these points now. Enterprise strategic plan refers to what is the strategy of the enterprise and what is its direction. So where does the enterprise want to go and what is its ultimate targets? That is what is given in enterprise strategic plan. The second point is information system strategic plan. This deals with based on the enterprise strategic plan, how will the IT assets of the organization support that enterprise to achieve that plan. So how is the IT assets of the organization used for achieving that plan? So we look at what are the enablers of this plan. This is quite important from exam point of view. You can again rearrange the points here so that you get a more logical connect to understand the points. First we'll have the enterprise business strategy. Then definition of how IT should support those business objectives. Point number 3 is inventory of the technological solutions and current infrastructures. This is what we have at the moment. Then point 4 is existing systems assessments. So this is what we have. This is an assessment of what is the capabilities of what we have at the moment. Number 5 is timely feasibility studies and reality checks. So these checks have to be conducted in an often manner. So it should be conducted regularly to see where the enterprise stands and what is the current capability of the IT systems. Then point 6 is technology markets. This is to see whether anything interesting or required by the enterprise is upcoming in the market. And point number 7 is need for senior management buy-in, support and critical review. So if there is something which has been identified that needs to be purchased by the entity regarding the IT assets, senior management will have to support that so that they can be buying that and implementing. So these are the enablers for the information system strategic plan. That is, how does IT assets support the enterprise objective? And below that, in the hierarchy, comes the information systems requirements plan. So once it is decided on how the IT assets are going to support the enterprise, the technical specifications and requirements will have to be chalked out. That is what is developed here. Based on the information system architecture requirements, information systems requirements plan will be developed. So what is the information system architecture? That architecture plan and what is the level of technology which is required to be used, that will be developed or decided, and based on that we look at the enablers for the information system requirement plan. This is quite complex and it's quite hard to understand, so you will have to practice this maybe 5-6 times for you to understand these points. Point 1 is information enterprise information architectural standards. This is the standard, something similar to our auditing standards, accounting standards. So information system architecture also has different standards. So that is what is being talked about here. Second one is information model representing the business. This particular point deals with how is the existing information system of the business. That particular system is modeled. Point 3 is data ownership, criticality and security classification. So how is data classified as sensitive or non-sensitive, that classification. Point 4 is automated data repository and dictionary. So this is a data repository, and where is data stored and what is the definition of that data. Number 5, data syntax rules. This is how does data is stored in the system. So in Excel, if you write the formula wrong, you get something known as a syntax error. That is, you have not given the code in the manner that the system expects you to. So this is a system language, and this is how the system understands. That is what is called by data syntax rules. That is, how is the data required to be fed into the system so that it understands it. Next, we move on to the last point, which is information system applications and facilities plan. This plan has these 4 points. These are very simple to understand, and you can read it once and get it. Next, we move on to key management practices for aligning IT strategy with the enterprise strategy. So here you need to remember this point, management practices. So this particular para, it talks about how we can align the IT strategy with the enterprise strategy. For that, it is again very logical. We first understand what is the enterprise strategy and where does the enterprise want to go. That is the enterprise direction. Then assess the current environment and its capabilities. So what do we have at the moment? Third one, define the target capability. Where do we want to reach? Fourth is conduct a gap analysis. What is the gap between the current performance and desired performance? That gap needs to be assessed. Number 5, define the strategic plan and a roadmap. So to bridge that gap, we need to define a strategy on how we will be achieving the target. And the last one is to communicate to everyone, all the stakeholders, that this is the plan, this is how we are going to achieve it. Next topic is business value from the use of IT. So what is the value of IT to the business? How does the business get any value add from IT? And how do we monitor it? It is again the 3 points from governance practices, that is EDM, evaluate, direct and monitor. Evaluate value optimization is what is the existing status of IT and what value add it is giving now. Direct is to direct the optimization in such a manner that we reach the target. The last point on monitor is to check regularly on whether the IT system is delivering the value as expected and whether we'll be able to achieve the target that is set. And here they have given on metrics for value optimization. This is how we measure whether the IT system is giving any value add or not. What are the measures which we will take to decide whether the IT system is giving value add or not? So there are 5 points here. First point is the percentage of IT enabled investments where benefit realization monitored. That is, on what percentage of IT assets are we monitoring this benefit realization? Suppose we invest 10 lakhs on the IT infrastructure. On what extent or what percentage of that investment are we going to monitor? That is, if we want to monitor 100%, we'll monitor how the entire 10 lakh is investment is, how is it giving returns to us. Second one is percentage where expected benefits are realized. So of that 10 lakh investment, suppose we decide that we will monitor the investments for 8 lakhs. The remaining 2 lakhs would be spread across multiple assets, and we will not find any requirement to monitor those. So we decide to monitor our investment on the rest of the 8 lakh rupees. So of that 8 lakhs, that may have maybe like 3 to 4 assets. We will see in what cases we are getting the expected benefits, realization of the expected benefits. And in the second point here, it talks about where the claimed benefits are exceeded. That is, what is the percentage of investments where we are getting more than 100% ROI. That is, whatever we had expected, that expectation has been exceeded by the returns. And here This is regarding in what cases are we clearly defining and approving the IT related costs and benefits. So if we invest something in IT, we should define what is the cost that we are going to incur and what is the benefits that we will be expecting out of that. And the next one is operational costs and expected benefits. Here it is IT related costs and benefits from the IT assets. Here it is operational costs and expected benefits. This is regarding what are the costs and benefits which we expect to incur on IT assets regarding its operation. So we need maintenance personnel, we need personnel who operate those assets. All those operational costs and benefits are looked after in this point. And satisfaction survey of the stakeholders. So we'll also interview the users of the assets and check whether they are happy with the assets, whether there is any modification or improvement required in that asset. So these are the 6 points based on which we can monitor and evaluate whether the IT assets are giving the expected value to the enterprise or not, whether we are getting the optimal return from the IT investments or not. Now we move on to the second topic for this video, which is regarding risk management. So in the earlier part, in part 1, we have already discussed the definition of risk management. Here we will be discussing the rest of the points regarding risk management. So first point here is regarding the sources of risk. What are the sources from which the entity faces risk? It can be legal relations, it can be economic circumstances, human behavior, natural elements. So all these are the sources from which entity may face risk. So natural events, you can take it as a flood, earthquake, or any other natural disaster, landslides. All these are natural events from which the entity will face risk. And here in the below paragraph, they have discussed on characteristics of risk. You can use the keyword as PALS to remember this. So P is loss potential of that risk. The second one is probability of that loss. The third one is probability that a specific attack may be mounted against a particular system. So the second and third point here are connected. Point 1 talks about what is the extent of loss in monetary terms which will be faced. So if a virus attack occurs on our system, what is the monetary loss that may be caused to us? That is what first point talks about. Second point talks about what is the probability of such a threat. That is, what is the chance that such an attack can occur on our system. Point 3 talks about what is the probability that a specific attack can be mounted against a system. So if an attacker knows that some of our systems are weak, they can mount an attack specifically on that system. So third point talks about what is the probability of an attack on that particular system. And the next topics are related to the definition of certain key terms. The first one is asset. Asset means something of value to the organization, and asset has these four characteristics. So the first point it has value to the organization. It cannot be replaced easily. It forms a part of the organization's identity, and data classification is very high. That is, the data which goes into these assets and data stored in these assets, it has very, very high value to the enterprise. So that is what is the characteristics and meaning of the term asset. And next topic or next point is vulnerability. Vulnerability is referring to the weakness in the system. So if you look at any kind of virus attack or anything, you will be commonly hearing the term that it was vulnerable to attack. So vulnerable means the weakness that is there in the system. So there may be 10 attack points which are there, but 9 of them have been covered with adequate controls and one of them has been left open. So that is the weakness which can be used to attack that system. And vulnerability has these following characteristics. That is, any other attacker can execute commands as another user and the access is contrary to the specified access restrictions, and it allows the attacker to pose as another entity, that is impersonation, and allows the attacker to conduct a denial of service. Denial of service means the authorized user is unable to get access to that service because the server has been flooded with too many unauthorized requests. It just disables the server, and the server is overloaded and unable to respond. And that is a type of denial of service attack. The next point is regarding threat. Threat is any agent which can mount the attack using the vulnerability. Threat is, suppose we know of a virus which is there. So few months back we had heard about this virus called WannaCry, that is WannaCryptor, which had attacked several banking systems, several accounts, and it had compromised the money that was stored there, and it had also compromised the information that was stored in all these accounts. So that virus is a threat. If we have a vulnerability, the threat can exploit that vulnerability to attack us. Threat is an external agent basically. Exposure means the extent of loss. So what is the extent of loss which would be caused in case the attack is successful? That is what is called as exposure. Likelihood is probability of success. So what is the chances that if an attack is mounted, it will succeed? That is what is called likelihood. Attack is attempt to gain unauthorized access. So the threat agent will use the vulnerability in the system to mount an attack. You can remember all the 3 points by using this particular, by just remembering this point. That is, a threat can use the vulnerability in the system to mount an attack. So by remembering this, you will also remember all the meanings of these 3 points. Then there is a term, risk. Risk is what is the potential harm caused. So risk and exposure are connected with each other. Exposure is the extent of loss, and risk is the chance of the loss. And here they have talked about the need to protect information systems, and they have talked about the use of technology and how in the recent past it's become very difficult to protect the information systems. Then the next point is regarding countermeasure. A countermeasure is what the organization takes as a action to reduce the vulnerability. So we have known that there is a vulnerability in the system, that is an open attack point. So we put up controls to counter that threat. That is what is meant by countermeasure. And after mitigating all the risk, if there is something remaining, it is called residual risk. So if the risk was 100, we put controls to reduce that risk to 90, or rather 10 exactly. So 90 is the risk which we reduced, and 10 is the residual risk which still remains. And next we move on to risk management strategies. So there are 5 strategies which they have talked about here, and here they have not given it in the exact order, so you can just look at this point and remember it. The first strategy would be to tolerate the risk. So if the risk is minuscule, or it is like totally negligible in nature, you can tolerate it and just continue. The next one is to ignore. This is again the same thing, where the risk is very minuscule and the likelihood of such event happening is rare. In such a case, you can entirely ignore it. So first you can remember it as ignore, so that is, you will not bother. Then tolerate is where it is, impact is very minimal. You choose to just tolerate it, accept it as a cost and continue. The third one would be to entirely eliminate the risk. So if you take, for example, if you have put adequate controls to mitigate the risk, you can entirely eliminate the risk. So say for example, the password of the system which you are using, it is weak. So that is a vulnerability. So we use some very cryptic password, we use some blockchain technology and other things, we secure the system. So we entirely eliminate that risk. Fourth one is to to transfer the risk. Transfer the risk is where we choose to shift some portion of our risk to someone else. So if we take an insurance policy against a fire accident, that is we transfer some portion of our risk to the insurance agent. That is transferring. Mitigating is where we take action from our side to reduce that risk. So we train our employees to respond to fire accidents. We put up fire extinguishers everywhere. We design the building in such a way that fire accidents don't occur. We properly take measures to ensure that electrical faults and electrical fires don't occur. These are risk mitigation strategies which we adopt. So the five strategies are ignore, then tolerate, then eliminate, and transfer. The last one is mitigate. And the next one is governance practices of risk management, which is again the same thing, EDM. Evaluate what it is now, direct it to get the risk within the selected appetite, or what is the level of risk which we want to take. We want to get the risk to within that level, then monitor. That is whether the risk is coming within that level or exceeding it. We'll monitor that. And the last but one topic of this video is the management practices of risk management. Again, you can remember this using a logical flow so that you'll remember all the points. First one is to collect the data that is required for us to assess the risk. Next is analyze the risk. Third one is maintain a risk profile. Fourth is articulate the risk. Fifth, define a risk management action portfolio. And sixth, respond to risk. So the logic here is, first we collect the data and we analyze the risk. Then we maintain a risk profile coming on the basis of our analysis. So we analyze the risk and we maintain a profile. So what is the level of risk that we have analyzed? And then we articulate the risk. That is, we understand whether this risk is within our acceptable limits or whether it exceeds. Then define a risk management action portfolio. So we define an action on how we are going to reduce the risk to within acceptable levels. Last one, respond to the risk. Take action. So this is the logical way in which you can remember all the points that are given here. And the last topic for this video is metrics of risk management. So how will you measure whether your risk management strategies are actually having effect or not? So there are only 4 points which are given here. Percentage of the critical business processes covered by the risk assessment. So what is the percentage of critical processes which is covered by this activity? So if there are 10 processes which we have identified as being critical, whether we covered all the 10 or whether we covered only a part of it, that is what is this point is saying. Number of significant IT related incidents that were not identified. So we chose to cover 8, for example, and from the other 2 processes there were some incidents which we could not identify. That is what second point was saying. Third one is percentage of enterprise risk assessments including IT related risks. This talks about what is the percentage of the risk assessment which we have done. That is, what is the level of risk that we have actually identified. And then frequency of updating the risk profile. So we did risk assessment and we identify certain risks. We maintained the risk profile. What is the frequency based on which we will be updating the risk profile? That is, how often we will conduct this risk assessment to update risk profile. That is what is talked about in the fourth point. So metrics of risk management talks about how is our risk management practices and strategies working, and whether we are able to achieve our objective of mitigating the risks to our acceptable limits or not. So with that, we have come to an end of the second part. We talked about the IT strategy and its related subtopics, and risk management and its related subtopics. There are 2 more videos on the first chapter. Hope you also watch those videos as well. Thanks for watching.